Hello, this is the Westminster Standard. I'm Ryan Biese, and we're doing a crossover podcast with the Presbyterian and Reformed Churchmen. George Sayour, thanks for participating.
Yes, Ryan, thank you. Yes, so for PNR Churchmen, Ryan and I were fighting over this guest, and I claimed I claimed rights because of the ruling elder status. But of course, that's, you know, Ryan and the Westminster Standard podcast has ruling elders too. So Ryan does a professional, good job. I appreciate his work very much, and so he will run this interview. But we'll both run it on PNR Churchmen and the Westminster Standard podcast, and hence his late logo and his banners, like we are official. PNR Churchmen is not used to this, that's for sure.
Well, we're joined today by Charles Higham, a ruling elder at and clerk of session at Westminster Presbyterian Church. Is it in Sumter, South Carolina?
Sumter, South Carolina.
So first, I know Ryan and I would both say this. Thank you, first of all, for sharing your story. It is vulnerable. It is probably uncomfortable. And this got born out of a number of tweets that you had felt compelled to do, mm-hmm. that I'm sure we're going to talk about, where you reject side B gay Christianity now. And there you go. I've been wrestling with doing this for some time, but it seems the Lord won't let me sit on it. I used to support Revoice and even attended the 2022 conference. First of all, this was brave, because it would be very easy to just not say this publicly, you know, mm-hmm. not, I mean, this is repentance, right? I mean, you could just change your view quietly and then support a new view, but you felt the need, because of your own walk and struggle, to communicate this. And I think that's brave, and I commend you. And you are speaking about sensitive things from your childhood that isn't easy to admit.
Well, Charles, thanks for being on the show. Would you give us a little personal biography, background, how long you've been ministering, and where? I know we were talking a little bit earlier about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I'm basically from Sumter at this point. I've lived here since I was 6 years old. My parents divorced when I was very young. And my mom, my older sister, and I moved in with my grandma and grandpa. My grandpa passed away, so that left me in a house of three women. So I tell people all the time, I was raised by three women, my mom, my grandma, and my older sister. So, and generally, that's when I say, well, so if you wonder what's wrong with me, that's it right there. No, but, we lived in New Mexico, and then we moved from there to, South Carolina here. And that's, that's kind of the early life. School was always kind of hard for me. Not hard like the academics, but I just didn't get along well with others. I was always a bit of a nerd. One of the things that I love to tell people, I don't know that I've missed a chance yet, I'm a huge Godzilla fan. I own everything Godzilla related that I can affordably get my hands on.
You know, my son loves Godzilla.
Your son is awesome. So
I know. Job. I know.
But anyway, so, you know, it's like I had the more nerdy hobbies, and that just wasn't cool on the schoolyard. I was kind of bullied a lot. We didn't grow up in church. We were a Christmas Eve family. We weren't even Easter Sunday. Like, just we would occasionally go on Christmas Eve with my grandma's sister and her family. Across the street from us, a pastor and his family moved in, and he was an Assemblies of God pastor. He invited me to Wednesday night activities at their church. It was a program called Royal Rangers. I don't know how familiar you are with the Assemblies of God, but I joke with people that it's the Pentecostal Boy Scouts. Yeah. but anyway, so I like going, I like being around the people there. So I just kind of went on into youth group and all that stuff. Middle school, my life got really complicated because, one, it was middle school. But like, it seemed like the bullying got a lot worse. It seemed like just everything, I couldn't do anything right. I could just, you know, I just felt like a complete failure at everything. And during this time, there were kind of two things that happened. And one was I began being sexually abused by an older cousin. And I didn't know what that was. I didn't know what to call it. I didn't know, you know, what to do with that. And then in my eighth grade year, I actually started experiencing same-sex attraction. As I most recently described it in a recent testimony I gave, you know, I started experiencing homosexual lust towards one of my classmates. It was a very specific thing. And then it just kind of grew from there. I just had this uncontrollable thing. I couldn't deal with it. I thought I was like, is this a phase? Am I going to grow out of this? But I also, after my eighth grade year, in between eighth and ninth grade, I went to a church camp. And I went to this church camp thinking to myself that I don't want anything to do with the whole God thing. I don't know what I would have considered myself then. I was a theist at a very basic level. But I don't know beyond that, like I wouldn't have called myself a Christian or anything, but, I want the whole God thing. I don't care about the whole Jesus thing. I just want to go have a good time. Well, as I like to say, God had other plans. And that was when, I first really heard the gospel, and not that I hadn't heard it before, but obviously, you know, I hadn't believed on it. I hadn't heard it with faith. And it was there at that church camp I became a Christian. And then after church camp, I'm like, well, I'm a Christian now. I'm not going to lust anymore. I'm not going to have these feelings or experiences anymore.
Charles, what year was that? What year was
1996?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So I was like, I'm just not going to do that anymore. And as I tell people, old habits die hard and so does sin. And I found myself, you know, going back to those fantasies and all of that stuff. Later found internet pornography. This was on dial-up internet. And I had no idea it even existed. I knew that there was pornography, but I didn't know that there was gay porn out there. And I still don't remember exactly how I found it, but once I did, it was like, you know, it was a new thing and became very addictive to me. Graduated high school. I went to Bible college afterwards. Went to Columbia International University. Got my bachelor's in intercultural studies, a minor in teaching English as a foreign language. Started to actually talk about it there. I didn't feel like I could talk about struggling with same-sex attraction when I was, you know, in high school, when I was in church. I just had this idea that these people are perfect and they won't understand this. In fact, they would probably hate me if they found out that I was dealing with this. I couldn't talk to anybody, but finally in college, I'm like, I need to talk to people. You know, I need to let somebody in on this and started actually talking about like, hey, these are what I'm struggling with. And I found there, you know, people didn't like instantly reject me because, oh, well, you know, you're that guy, you're dirty. You know, they didn't treat me as unclean. They didn't treat me as second rate. They actually, were encouraging. They wanted to be able to help, provided some accountability. Still,
Would you say that was the students or the teachers or both?
Yes, both. Yeah, more so the students, but there were a few professors and other leaders at the university that I was able to open up to. And that was a good time. I started, you know, digging into the scriptures a lot more. Obviously, you kind of have to in Bible college. I had discovered at this point Exodus International. Exodus International, I forget when they were founded, but they were kind of the largest, quote unquote, ex-gay ministry probably in the world for a long time. I had heard about them and I was basically still trying to figure out how to fix this. I tell people, you know, what I was looking for in my own journey struggling with sexual sin was I was looking for the key that was going to unlock everything, and then I would be normal. And I tell people now, you know, normal is just a setting on the dryer. but, you know, so that was kind of my own journey in trying to deal with this. So after college, you know, I'm still kind of struggling, still giving in to the addictive cycle, as they call it, with pornography and all of that. And so I went from there, or went from college after a couple of years working at a year-round camp. I went to Turkey to teach English as a second language to an international students at a school in Turkey. It was a secular school that just happened to be staffed entirely by Christians. And so our goal was to incorporate gospel lessons into the regular curriculum. And I'd say most of the teachers were pretty good at that. But I went there, and even as I interviewed there, you know, they ask if there's anything they should know about. And I knew that I should have said something about my struggle, but I decided to say, no, there's nothing else. I essentially lied to them because I knew that this could be disqualifying, and I didn't want to be disqualified. And so, you know, it was dishonest on my part. And that would later, after I left Turkey.
What did they ask? What question did they ask? They ask if you did porn, or did they, I mean,
asked about, let's see. I think it was like, there were questions about, you know, my life with the Lord and all that kind of stuff. So there's some general questions, but there's like, there's a question about your relationships with the opposite sex. And I said, well, they're fine. Like, there's nothing to worry about there. They didn't ask about the same sex specifically, but then they asked, you know, is there anything else that you think we need to know about you? And again, even in that moment, I felt a little bit of conviction that I should tell them, but I decided to keep my mouth closed. And that was a bad decision. I didn't realize how bad of a decision it was, until looking back. I was thinking about it, and I was like, you know, we were in kind of a hostile environment in Turkey. They weren't necessarily too fond of our school. It was actually birthed out of a school that the government had shut down, the Turkish government had shut down. So this, you know, like if something like this had been found out, it could have given the school cause to shut us down, or the government shut the school down. So I realized, like, that was really stupid. I say that a lot. I'm a dumb guy. I don't learn very quickly, but I also got engaged to a girl while I was over there. She was an Iraqi refugee. She was a Christian. She was, you know, well known in the international community and in the Christian community there. And we got along well, and, you know, it kind of was like, well, I don't know, but a lot of people seem to think we should get together, so let's just give it a try. And eventually I did tell her about my struggles, but, you know, but I still kept a lot of my, like, fear inside, and, like, I don't think we can make this work. We got engaged, and I mean, again, looking back, I realized, like, you know, I was doing a lot of this just to keep the appearance of normal. So that was, you know, like, I did genuinely care about her. I wouldn't say that we had any romantic or sexual attraction between us. And so, like, the whole time I'm like, you know, maybe just, you know, if we get married, it'll be fine and whatever. Long story short, I came back to the States after my contract ended. And after about a year back in the States, the principal's wife had read an email that I'd sent to my fiance complaining about a lot of stuff. Our relationship got really tense once we were apart. But I sent an email complaining to her about everything and how bad I was struggling and how she wasn't being supportive. And I didn't realize that that email had gotten read by someone else. Well, it was the principal's wife. This is the principal that hired me. They consider this girl like a daughter. And so they were very sharp in their rebuke. They said, you need to get help and you need to break off this engagement, you know? And so I was like, you know what? You're right. I need to break off the engagement. So I broke off the engagement, but was still convinced I can get over this myself.
So you did the one, but not the other. You broke off the engagement, but didn't
seek help. I did not immediately seek help. Again, I'm slow.
But you spend a lot of time in the library, I understand.
Yeah, yeah. I actually had a part-time – I'd gotten a part-time job at the library. I had just come out of one job and was kind of like, well, I don't know what to do next. The library is hiring. Let me just apply for that and go there. Well, about a year after all of that happened, at that same time, I started going to Westminster Presbyterian Church. So I had embraced Reformed theology pretty much at that point and was looking for a new church because the home church, I just didn't really fit there. And so I was just kind of like, I love these people, but there were just, you know, concerns over doctrine and some of the practice. And so I was kind of like, I really want to be around other Reformed people. I visited a couple of other churches. I would have probably called myself Reformed Baptist at that point. But anyway, ended up visited a couple of the Baptist churches and I was like, kind of like, I don't know. And then I was like, wait a minute. I'm like, I visited a PCA church down on Hilton Head when I was working and living down there. Yeah, I was there for a year on Hilton Head. And so I visited a church down there for a while. I really liked it. And I was like, let me see what denomination that was, because I want to make sure I get in the right, you know, the right Presbyterian denomination. I don't think the word PCA was in my vocabulary. It was just Presbyterian, but I want to make sure I got with the right ones. And so that's how I found what I found. They were PCA, Westminster's PCA. Okay, I'm going to go to Westminster. And right from the start, it was like fantastic. I really enjoyed the people. I mean, like, you know, within my first day, my first service visiting, where I was talking to some people afterwards and had like several deeper theological discussions with people. That's like, this hasn't happened in like ever. So I got in PCA, but anyway, so I ended up joining Westminster. So about a year after the engagement ended and I kind of moved back to Sumter. I was,
what year?
With my grandma at the time.
What year are we talking?
This is 2009, 2010. Okay. So 2009, yeah. I moved back to Sumter. 2010, I got caught looking at pornography at work. And should have lost my job. I was suspended. I was again very sharply rebuked. And that's when I finally realized I can't do this. I can't beat this and I'm going to need help. I started going to some counseling. Our town has a local Celebrate Recovery chapter, and so I kind of became a part of that. Just started again being more honest about my struggles and working harder to like, okay, you know, what do I actually need to work on here? So I feel, Charles, like this isn't very brief. This is like 15 minutes.
Yeah. So Charles, my question before you move into the next phase is,
yeah,
at this time where, you know, you were maybe, to use some language, is like in the closet, trying to keep it in the closet. What was your understanding and relationship to the desire? Like, did you, you know, because a lot of these discussions now center around this theological word called concupiscence.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, in the Reformed world, we have a different understanding of that than say people in the Catholic world or even broadly evangelical world.
Mm-hmm.
So what did, like, was it for you just a shame thing, or was it about the fact that you recognized there was a stigma to it, so you didn't want it to come out? Or did you, recognize at that point, particularly before you were in a PCA church, that it was that the desire itself was objectively wrong. Like, where was your relationship to the to it at that point?
Yeah, I think I had just always seen it as like, this is a, you know, this is a temptation, not a sin kind of thing, unless you act on it. When I cooperated with it, it became a sin, which
that's a Catholic view probably.
Yeah, that's much more of a yeah, I realize now that's the Catholic view. But I was, yeah, I was definitely much more like, well, this is just a temptation that I have to overcome. So there was also a shame and the social stigma, you know, don't ask, don't tell was the policy of the day. There were discussions about gay rights and gay marriage and stuff like that, but there wasn't like prominently front and central in the culture at the time. There was still a lot of room for disagreement and all of that kind of stuff. But it was, yeah, it was a, so yeah, some shame and some just like, well, this is just a temptation and I just need to be able to beat it. And you know, I should be able to do that.
Would you say the moral dilemma for you was more the fact that it, again, in the Christian world community you were in, there was stigma. So that was more the pressure you felt, or did you feel an internal pressure that it was wrong?
I probably wouldn't articulate it quite that way. Mm-hmm. I knew it was not right. Not normal is, again, I keep going back to that word normal, but I knew that it, you know, this isn't something that I should ever be proud of. And you know, but it's, you know, I guess probably my view followed more of the Exodus international approach, where it's, you know, it's caused by all of these events that I went through, you know, not having my father in the home, not feeling a close connection with him, not, you know, not bonding well with my peers. And that's kind of the model yeah. of development that most of what are called the ex-gay ministries kind of use. Mm.
Yeah. So brother, let me just tell you, like growing up, I had all kinds of things I was ashamed of, and I didn't need it to be, you know, the stigma to do it. I just knew, you know, there's we're fallen, you know, even as a, you know, I was Catholic actually. But I still understood, like, why am I, whether it was hate or lust or whatever, why am I feeling these things? You know? So again, I don't want you to feel like this one thing is
right. Right.
You know, so.
Yeah. I would say, I mean, most of my focus was on the one thing and, it seemed like at least my biggest sin struggle. And so it's like, you know, if I can just take care of this one thing, then I'll be sanctified. Like it was kind of a, you know, yeah. I mean, that was the thing. There was a pursuit of perfection in me that was unhealthy. And even again, growing up, I'll put it this way. I was never told that every time I sinned, I was going to hell as a Christian. But I don't think I was ever told that that wasn't true either. And so it was especially again with the shame that I felt over the same sex lust was, you know, it was very much like, I fell again. So now I've lost my salvation and now I've got to, you know, make it up to God somehow. and so, yeah, it was a terrible cycle. And
yeah,
that's why Reformed theology is so comforting. It's like, you know, not that we can just do whatever we want, but like, you know, it's not, oh, God loves me, God loves me not, God loves me, God loves me not, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah. But, you know, it's, you referenced you've married and you have a family now.
Yes.
So, you know, as you're struggling with this and you went to the Revoice, conference in 2022. So
yeah.
Still, this struggle has been a lifelong struggle, and yet, you know, striving for holiness.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about that.
Yeah. So, yeah. So, my wife and I actually met at the library. She started working there. We spent weekends in the same department. Struck up a really good friendship. We were friends for about 4.5 years. And, you know, everyone was like, you know, I'm like, you're all going to start dating. And like, even our youth group, we were working with the church youth group at the time. And they were calling us Chim. Her name is Kim. And so they were calling us Chim. That was their little, like, they, and so they were wanting us together. Everybody was wanting us together. I think really she was wanting us together, but was understanding that, well, you know, I've got the struggle and I just don't know if I can make it work. And it's ironic. It was actually an article on spiritual friendship, which is Wesley Hill's website, a guy talking about mixed orientation marriage. I put that in quotes now. But you know, it was like, I was like, okay, I'm like, I don't really agree with the terminology thing. I'm like, but the friendship he describes with this girl sounds a lot like me and Kim. Like, maybe we could we possibly get together? And so, like, I sent her the article, and I sent her blogs all the time, so, you know, it wasn't abnormal for me to send her stuff, but I sent her that, and she was, like, awkward. She's like, you know, like, this kind of sounds like us. Like, I don't want to, like, you know, make it weird or anything, and I'm like, I was kind of thinking the same thing, so what do you think we should do? So we talked, and we prayed. We went to friends, and we went to our pastor, sought counsel and all that, and basically we were like, well, we think that this is, we'll give it a go and see what happens. And so we started dating. 2.5 months later we got engaged, and then 300 days exactly after that, we only know because we did a countdown, well, it was when we got married. So it's like, once we started dating, it was very much like, you know, okay, this is gonna work. And and, you know, and again, it was nice when, you know, she knew about the struggles, and I tried to be open about any fears that came up. But at the same time, I was trusting the Lord to work out the details. And, you know, yeah, that was in 2016. We got married. Our daughter was born 1 year and 1 week later. Her name's Gracelyn. We named her Gracelyn because it means basically waterfall of grace or river of grace. And it's like, we like that. So, and then 1.5 years later, my son was born, and I had already decided that my firstborn son was going to be a junior. So, and we were going to call him CJ. And let me tell you, we could not have picked a better name for that kid. He is a miniature version of me in almost every way. He's 5 years old now. Huge Godzilla fan, just like me. And I'm like, yes, I have someone to pass the legacy on to.
We got to get our sons together.
Yeah. So I was, that was around the time when the Revoice debate was obviously starting to happen.
And, yeah, very intense.
And I mostly just stayed out of it. I was still kind of tied in with some of the ex-gay ministries, and they weren't too fond of Revoice and all that stuff. And really, what I thought the issue boiled down to is kind of like what some people are still saying, that, you know, maybe this is a semantics thing. It's just, they're just using the label, but, you know, not in any, like, maybe not necessarily in a way that's negative or anything like that. And so it's kind of like, yeah, that's probably not the way that I'm going to go. You know, I'm just going to stick with the people that I'm with and keep learning and growing here. Well, a good friend of mine that I'd met actually through one of the ex-gay ministries had read Greg's book after it came out, and Greg Johnson's book, Still Time to Care. And so he was like, you got to read this book, man. It's so good. And this is somebody, I mean, he was in the PCA. That's how we became friends. We met at an ex-gay conference, and we were both PCA guys. And so it's like, well, great, we're both reformed. This is fantastic. So we went around picking on the Pentecostals the rest of the week. But, half joking there, half. But anyway, we had a good friendship and stuff. And then so he was like, yeah, you got to read Greg's book. And I was like, I'm like, Greg's associated with Revoice. And I didn't realize that it was, you know, that Greg was the pastor of Memorial, you know, and that Memorial was at the heart of the heart of the first conference and focus of the, you know, what kind of brought this debate into our circles.
Were you a ruling elder at this point?
No. I didn't become a ruling elder until 20, Well, 2021. So yeah, around that time. So it was shortly after, I guess probably shortly around the time when, yeah, I read Greg's book, again, at my friend's ongoing insistence. And I was like, yeah, I'm like, I think he says some good things, but I still don't know. I mean, you know, Revoice is kind of just a thing and everyone seems to say no. And so it's like, I wasn't going to go there. And then my friend was like, well, you know, why don't we go to the conference? I'll pay for you to go to the conference. So I was just like,
Free trip to St. Louis or wherever it was that
year. It was at Dallas that year. Dallas. Okay. But yeah, so I was like, well, I'm like, okay, well, I'll think about it. I still wasn't really like on board. And I'm ashamed to say this, what kind of finally made everything fall into place and for me to start actually being in favor of Revoice was really, it was my own lust. And I wasn't looking at anything pornographic or anything, but it was like, I was on Instagram and scrolled across a reel and it had like two guys sharing a kiss. And it's like, you know, like I don't support this, but you know, I would, at the time I would have said that I found something beautiful in it, which, you know, I mean, it's just, yeah, it's sin. It was my own sin deceiving me.
Yeah, but, and that's such a great point.
This isn't right, but it's obvious that these two guys love each other and that love is real. And that's one of the big things in Revoice. You know, the love is real, but the sex is bad kind of thing. And so that was just like, when I said it, I was sitting there thinking about it and I'm just like, I'm gay. And that was the first time I ever said those words, even out loud. It was just to myself at that moment. But I was just like, oh, well, that explains everything. You know, and so I went to my friend and I came out to him and said, hey, dude, I'm gay. And he's like, great, man. And so I was like, yeah, he had, you know, started using the gay label himself at that point. And so, you know, when I said that to him, then he's like, yeah. And then there was another good friend of mine. I said, yeah, like, you know, I had, I don't think I'd recommended him Greg's book at that point, or maybe I can't remember. But anyway, I had another friend and I, you know, had a little coming out with him. I came out to my wife, told her, yeah, I'm gay. And, you know, not that I'm going to leave or anything like that. I don't have any plans of leaving. I want to be in this marriage, but it's just, this is just making sense of my life so far. So
before that, because this is a distinction I've attempted to make in articles I've written and stuff, but like before that, you would have viewed it as desire, descriptive of desire, and Revoice made you view it as defining of personhood.
I think so. I think I still tried to nuance it. Like, you know, I'm not saying this is who I am, but this is just, you know, this fits my struggle. This fits just, you know, and so even in saying those terms, I don't think I really fully embraced what Revoice means by those terms.
But I think, you know, you highlighted an important aspect and a reality that our experience often shapes what we believe is true. And so it wasn't that you know, the scripture had convinced you that I can have this conception of myself, even if I don't act on it. It was, this feels good, so it must be, it must be right.
And that's essentially it. It was like, you know, well, this feels right, so this feels like the right way to go. So this is, you know, again, not that I was going to embrace, you know, homosexual activity or marriage or anything like that, but you know, yeah, that was kind of at the heart. It was my own experience was saying, well, this must be right.
Because how can this be wrong?
Yeah.
So what were some of the takeaways from the 20, you said you went to the 2022 conference. What were some of the takeaways? Did that help you settle into that position for a season?
Not really. When going there, I was kind of uncomfortable the whole time. Even like, and it was funny because I was so excited. My wife thought I was too excited about it. She's like, I just, I don't, I'm not really coming to dinner. I kept talking about it. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to Revoice. Can't wait to go to Revoice. Can't wait to go hang out with my friend. And, you know, because we ended up, he lives in Tennessee. So we ended up meeting up in Atlanta and flying together out there and stayed together at a hotel and stuff like that. And so, you know, it was like, and there was a part of me that was like, you know, I am excited because it's a little bit of a break from the normal routine. Mm-hmm. You know, but yeah, I was there at the conference and I, you know, so I was excited. I mean, like I had my little notebook. I bought a notebook just for this conference so I could take copious notes. I'm also a terrible note taker. So you can guess that how my copious notes turned out. They're very sporadic and whatever. But going into the conference, I knew that they had one speaker that used the they, them pronouns. And I was kind of like, that seems a little like counterproductive, but you know, whatever. I can have my disagreements with them. And that's what I saw that may be just a little quibble. Cause you know, so I was like, well, I'm like, I'm just gonna, you know, keep going through with this and listen to the speakers. And there's some stuff that's like, yeah, that's pretty good. And then there was some stuff that was like, I don't know why I don't like this. Like this doesn't quite seem right. And I couldn't articulate it at that moment. But
it didn't pass the smell test.
There was a smell, a spiritual smell test that was like something's off. And I couldn't quite figure it all out. And, you know, like even when like the person I was most excited to see was Greg Johnson, because I'd read his book. I actually had him autograph my book while I was there, because my wife actually kind of insists on getting books signed every chance you can. So, and I was like, yeah, I was like, well, I'm like, plus I really like this book. I mean, I've recommended this book to lots of people now at this point. So his talk was the one that I was probably the most excited about. And like when he was done, I was just kind of like, okay, that was something. Like he spoke from the text about, you know, where Jesus says, you know, these who do my will are my mother and brothers and sisters. And rather than it be about, you know, because what Jesus seems to be getting at there, if I'm understanding the text correctly, is, you know, he's saying, you know, basically those who do my Father's will are my family and by extension, our family. You know, others who are pursuing Christ together are our spiritual family. But the way Greg seemed to go with that text was more about the, you know, the idea of chosen family. We don't have to accept less things. We can go create our own families, so to speak. And I was just kind of like one of the things he said in that talk was, he said, being married doesn't make you happy. It makes you married. And I'm like, okay, that's in a sense a true statement, but that doesn't, that negates the fact that I do enjoy being married. And like that, again, that didn't fit the experience, you know? So it's like, there is joy and happiness that have come from my marriage that I don't think I would have had if I were not married.
Marriage, you know, is so a blessing. Marriage is a blessing, right?
It's kind of almost like God created it for our good and our enjoyment.
Yeah. It's kind of a banal statement to say, well, marriage just makes you married. Well, of course it does.
Well, and that was the thing. It's like, you know, I get on the one hand, you know, I mean, the point he may have been trying to make was that, you know, marriage isn't going to solve all of your problems.
And that's true.
Absolutely. I can get on board with that. But it was just, like I said, it was that overall tone. And I think I even wrote it in my little review that they give us to fill out at the end of the conference. I was like, you know, I felt marginalized as a married person in this environment. You know, and I mean, I know the Revoice founder, Nate Collins, is married and they had the little affinity groups during breakouts, and they had a one for mixed orientation marriages. And I went to that, but it's just like, overall, I felt like this doesn't really seem to be honoring marriage as God designed it. Amen. And so I was like, yeah, I left the conference and I was like, yeah, I'm like, it was good, but I don't know. Like, I think when I got back, I told my wife, I'm like, I don't know that I would go to another one at this point. Like, at the time I would have said, I'm okay with it, but maybe that's not going to be for me kind of thing. And so then of course, after the conference, all of the, you know, opinion pieces on both sides start coming out. And one that really stuck with me was Carl Truman's piece in World. The article was called Into the Anthropological Chaos. And his point was talking about how the gender confusion, the lady using the they, them pronouns, introduces the gender confusion. And that's, you know, showing that Revoice is going further off the rails. But that wasn't what stood out to me in the article. What stood out to me, one of the things he says in that article, I've got it pulled up here. It says, it's hard to find one high profile critic of the movement who was taken with real seriousness by Revoice advocates. And that was like, I couldn't respond to that. I was just kind of like, I was left dumbfounded. And I was like, yeah. And, you know, because I mean, one of the things that I've seen over and over and over again is when someone criticizes something Revoice proponents are, well, they're a heretic, they're a hypocrite, they're, you know, they're passing judgment. They basically, you know, engage in the ad hominem attack.
Yeah.
You know, like, you're just a terrible person if you don't agree with us. And so it was like, I was like, you know, that's true. It's like Revoice doesn't seem to be able to actually argue their point face to face. You know, I mean, I know I would call Greg Johnson's book probably like the apologetic defense of Revoice. If I were to put it that way, but like, it seems like, you know, there's not the ability to say, oh, well, you know, here's what we mean when we use these labels. Here's, like, it didn't seem like any of that was going on. And maybe in the earlier days it was, but I, you know, again, I was getting more into the debates now. Yeah.
It seems like it's the same approach, you know, the folks from Moscow and the Federal Vision take. Well, you don't understand, or you're not serious, or you're not really reformed. We're the only ones that have this accurate truth. It's Gnostic, yeah. and postmodernist at the same time.
Yeah.
And I know, George, you've written on some of those issues. So what is it, if you could summarize in a sentence or two, what is it that is so dangerous about Revoice that you found in your own experience? And that, of course, verified by the scripture.
Yeah. My mind keeps going to James 4. Friendship with the world is enmity with God. And it seems like Revoice is the most dangerous thing about Revoice is that they're seeking the world's approval or at least the world's acceptance in some way. And, you know, I mean, Greg Johnson in his book says, like, he uses as an example of his approach, a conversation that he had with someone who was transgendered at one of some art show that his church, that their chapel hosted. And, you know, basically the proof that Greg used that this is the approach was that this transgender person said, well, you guys are the nicest Christians we've ever met. And it's like, is nice the goal of the gospel?
Right.
Like, there wasn't, you know, maybe it would have been more effective if he told the story of someone who actually came to their church and, you know, became a believer or something like that.
Came to faith,
like,
and repentance. Yeah.
That's the picture. Was, oh, they called us nice. They think we're nice. This is definitely the way to go because somebody on the opposite side called us nice. And so that's why I just like, and that was, again, when I was caught up in it, I was like, yeah, that's great. you know, but now I'm looking at it and I'm like, but what about repentance? Where is repentance? And that's where, you know, and I know it comes down again, concupiscence and that idea that sinful desires are in and of themselves sin to be repented of. And, you know, so, but it's like, yeah, so that was one of those things, again, looking back now, I'm like, yeah, that's wanting to be friends with the world. You know, we're going to adopt the world's language, we're going to adopt the world's categories, and we're just going to sprinkle a little Christianity on them. Hmm. But really, it sounds a lot more like the world than it does Christ.
Well, go ahead.
You got it, Ryan.
I see. Well, I just want to push back a little bit. You know, that some people have said, you know, here's a quote between the PresbyCast podcast and a former PresbyCast guest, Derek Radney, who says, in large part, the problem has been perception, particularly in how the PCA, TE's memorial are connected to it all that has been said at Revoice. So you're saying this isn't just a perception problem, if I understand you correctly. This is a worldliness problem.
I think so. And again, and I think Rosario Butterfield's new book really addresses this well when she talks about, you know, we're not talking about terminology, we're talking about ontology.
Yes.
And we're talking about anthropology. Another author I've read, Jared Moore, who's a Southern Baptist pastor, wrote a book called The Lust of the Flesh. And it's all on this idea of concupiscence. But and one of the things that he said is like, you know, we are doing theology from anthropology. He says that's what Revoice and those kind of movements are doing. They're saying, you know, well, these desires, I experience them, so they must not be bad in and of themselves, only if I act on them. But you know, so what is acting on them mean? Well, if it's only the physical act of sex, well, the floor is still wide open. And that was another thing. About a month, within a month of the Revoice conference happening, or a couple of months of the Revoice 22 happening, Greg shared an interview that he did with someplace in Europe. I can't remember where. But he had one of the questions he was asked, you know, if a gay couple comes to your church and believes in Jesus, what does discipleship look like? And he point blank said, I will not break them up. I just want them to desexualize the relationship.
Yeah, and he was being more and more open because they were leaving or had left.
Right. They had announced at that point. The date of that was October the 27th.
Yeah.
But I don't think it was aired until later.
Yeah. So my critique of the whole thing was it's like Gnostic. It's very Gnostic. It's very like the flesh is, we have to just suppress the flesh and not do certain things, you know?
Right.
And that's behavior management. That's not right. Mortification of sin. Like it's right. Getting at the root of something. And yeah. I often said, it seems to me as very hopeless. Like mm-hmm. if that's what I had to offer. And at the time I was working with a young man through this, if I had to offer him, yes, this is what and who you are, just don't do this. That seems to me to be soul crushing. If that's who you are, what you are, and you just have to just not act on it, as right. opposed to telling somebody, yeah, that's a real desire that you are experiencing. That's real. I'm not going to deny that in you, but that's not who you are. That's not what you are. And you're made for more. And there can be victory in this. Yeah. I do think it goes completely away in some people, but the ones many that I've talked to, I understand it's a part of their experience. Maybe the way, you know, lustful thoughts that pop into somebody's head can be a continued part of experience. The idea is it becomes less and less as you are rooted in seeking Christ. Anything in what I just said that you would disagree with or add to or...
No, I think that's good. And that's, I remember reading that kind of thought process, you know, the hopelessness of saying, well, this is who you are, but you can't do it, mm-hmm. you know, and
I wrote an article. I wrote an article that the joy robbing false hope of side B or something.
Yeah, I don't think I've read that one. I saw that you linked it in your recent post, but
yeah. Well, one of the things
shared today. So I'll make sure and read that for sure. But
yeah, that was.
Well, you don't have to. I'm just saying. That's,
yeah,
I was promoting that it's joy robbing because
right.
and really like okay, so I don't that has not been my struggle, but I have. Had inner drives toward a number of things in life and it's joy robbing.
Mm-hmm. So yeah. And that, again, looking back, I can see really there was a lot more of a toll that going in that direction was taking on me spiritually. Mm. My Bible reading went severely down.
Mm.
And you know, my time in prayer and even like, My focus became, you know, even about talking about my own struggles, well, I need to make sure and do this in a way that's not going to sound bad to Revoice. Like, you know, again, Greg's book really comes against the, what he calls the ex-gay script. And so it's like, you know, I rewrote my testimony that I had shared publicly multiple times and I rewrote it to try to, you know, I didn't use the terminology, you know, because still in my thinking, it's like that saying I'm gay publicly communicates something I don't want to communicate. And you know, again, that comes back to one of the issues that's led me out of that camp now, just the politics even behind the terminology. But anyway, but I rewrote my testimony. I was trying to like, okay, like, I don't want this to sound ex-gay. Like, yeah, I got married and had kids, but you know, I still, you know, I had to emphasize, I still struggle. I'm still, you know, I mean, again, I want to be honest, like, yes, I am still tempted in this area and I am, you know, I find it despicable. And, you know, again, coming back to that idea of concupiscence, you know, what I've started doing is like in those moments when I find a tempting thought floating through my mind is, you know, I take it to the Lord and I say, Lord, I am sorry that I am the kind of person that wants this.
Hmm.
You know, and so it's like the fact that this is even appealing to me shows that there is corruption in me.
Yeah.
And so that's, you know, but Revoice would have said, well, no, just the sex side is bad, but all of the other feelings and all of that kind of stuff.
Can you know,
those
would
be good. And you can, it's almost like you can have your sin and Jesus too.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you can be in this celibate partnership that they call it. And even they'll say it's gay marriage without the sex, you know, and it's like,
as if marriage is just sex, as it,
right.
As it, I mean,
and that's one thing in that clip from Greg Johnson, you know, he at the end, he says like, yeah, he said, I was talking to a guy, and he said after the first 10 years, the sex got boring, so now they just cuddle on the couch and are supportive of each other. And he would say, well, that's good. And it's well, like,
and George,
no.
Yeah, yeah. George, you a year or two ago, back in 22, got into a discussion on Twitter about this very issue that does Revoice promote, what was it, abominable immorality?
Who and, said that?
Paul Sandulik, I think he said.
Okay, yeah,
I think one major difference is that Revoice airs actively promote or come close to promoting abominable immorality of the kind that Christians cannot disagree upon and still be Christians. And then Derek Radney, no, this isn't true. Revoice does not promote abominable immorality. A difference over concupiscence does not warrant that charge. And so it seems like if there's this idea that you can be in a relationship without the sex, but still have it be good, that is abominable. That's the point you were making. George, you want to read your own tweet there?
So he was saying it's not, Revoice does not promote abominable immorality. I said, yes, it does. This isn't about concupiscence. This point isn't, of course. much of it is about concupiscence. Right, but I said, right. Promoting inherent goodness in gayness is blasphemy against our creator and a false anthropology. Promoting emotionally and often mentally sexual, though not physical, lifelong relationships is abominable. And I think, you know, I think our society has reduced romance to sex, and it's just not that. And as I think of my own kids, like, I don't want my daughter or my son giving their heart to somebody who they're not married to. Just, you know, my message to them is not simply just don't have sex with these people until you're married. It's don't give your heart over to somebody that your innermost emotional vulnerability is like that is revealed in marriage. And so this idea to say that a couple can, we're just going to desexualize the relationship, but this cuddling and petting can no, that's still a marriage. And by the way, it's still communicating the wrong view of marriage to the world. And Christians need to uphold, I mean, marriage is a picture of the gospel. And Revoice, I mean, so just to be clear, because this individual that's on your screen continues to promote that there's a spectrum of views and the whole thing. And at the end of the day, they promoted inherent goodness and gayness. There's gay attributes that will be celebrated in heaven. And, and again, spiritual friendships are a good thing. And I was glad to hear you say you don't like the language of a mixed orientation marriage, because to me that seems like it's not honoring to you or your wife or to your creator, who is, I mean, you're a married man, okay? And you have some desires you wish you didn't have, and strongly so. I think, like, again, that individual that was on your screen, I think my interactions with him is he's just trying to not, they don't, there's a certain group that doesn't like to ever condemn certain things, because it's part of their philosophy of ministry to, you know, it will shut down conversation if certain things are condemned. And, but I just don't believe it's holding out true hope in the gospel that has the power to give people hope and change. And so that's kind of why I mean, my concerns have not been culture war concerns. My concerns have been pastoral concerns on helping people to understand what it is to be made in the image of God.
Yeah, there's the argument that, you know, side B still has a place in the PCA.
I'm disgusted and shocked. It's still, people are still at online in the PCA. I'm not talking about outside, but in the PCA, questioning that there's latitude in the definition of side B, that there's some goodness in it, that we can partner with Revoice. No, you can't.
Yeah, and that's what Charles, you chimed in, that, you know, people don't understand what is meant by side B, but side B has a very clear, way it is used by Revoice now, right? As I understand it, that, you know, would you walk us through why you said this, that there's no room in the PCA for side B?
I mean, yeah, it feels like you're having to turn a blind eye to it at this point. I mean, we've been going round and round with this for 5 years now, 5-6 years, going on 6 years. So.
Yeah. 2018.
Yeah, 2018 was the first conference. And so I know since then it's been, I know it's been discussed in some circles before then, but still, I don't know how you can say that what they're holding to is just a difference of terminology or a difference of opinion or a difference of ministry philosophy. Yeah. It's a significant difference. If it's a difference, It's so significant. And again, the whole embracing of, you know, the trans pronouns thing. And that was another thing. When I got to the conference, you know, they say, here's some stickers. If you have a preferred pronoun you'd like to use, put that on your name tag. And I was kind of like, my pronouns are my pronouns. Like, just use English.
They were assigned at birth, right?
Yeah. I'm obviously a guy. I've got a nice beard here, you know. But, you know, so it's just, yeah, it feels like naivety or you know, deliberately overlooking the problems. Because that, like I said, that was kind of my approach initially. It's like, well, I have disagreements, and I don't think that would, you know, that should, like prior to my support of Revoice, it was like, yeah, I have disagreements, and maybe that's probably not the best way to go. You know, I wouldn't have said it was like bad at that point, but I would have been like, yeah, I don't think that's the right way to approach things. And again, I didn't even at that time understand a lot of the underlying controversies or underlying things, you know, the spiritual friendships, yeah, the celibate partnerships, the chosen family. I didn't realize how much of the queer theory had influenced their model. You know, and so, yeah, it's, we're not talking about difference of terms anymore. We can pretend that that's it, but I think we're deceiving ourselves if we're doing that. I think we are, you know, we're talking about personhood. We're talking about, you know, the lady that spoke who uses the they them pronouns. She was wearing a shirt that said Imago Dei and had the trans flag, you know, the stripes from the trans flag on Imago Dei. So it's almost saying transness is the image of God.
Well, and they, like, and they do say that. I mean, yeah,
That's kind of, again, I was kind of like, you know, everyone in the audience was like, yeah, when she like showed off her shirt, and I was just kind of like, is that?
So this is not a tertiary. This is a serious threat to the holiness and harmony of Christians.
Yeah.
You would say, as someone who's been down that road, who's been to these conferences, and who experiences very real struggles. You've seen the consequences of opening that door in your own friendships and relationships, as I gather.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I mean, it's like I look back now, and I, on a pretty regular basis, tell my wife I was so stupid to be a part of that. Like it was, you know, like I said, there was a lot of my own sticking my head in the sand. Yeah. Because it's like, well, but it feels right, you know. And that would have been like the only real defense I could have given. It's like, well, I mean, it just feels right. And then, you know, an argument I would go to is like, well, you know, if a pastor struggled with alcohol and said I'm an alcoholic, then, you know, are we going to like condemn him for that? Or, you know, is he identifying with this? Like, that's what I would have said when I was in support of Revoice. Right, but it's like, well, first of all, yeah, I think I would have an issue with a pastor who's like, yeah, I am an alcoholic.
Right.
I also know that alcohol, there's can be more of a genetic, physiological stuff. And so, you know, maybe using the term alcoholic in a certain way, he's not saying like, you know, again, apply the Revoice model to the alcoholic. Revoice says, well, you can't have gay sex, but you can have, you know, gay friendships and partnerships.
This is what they often flatten the group at PCA that push. They want to flatten all differences. And so my argument with the alcoholic thing, yeah, I wish AA hadn't sort of created this thing. But the truth is, nobody is redefining personhood by a propensity for a chemical dependency. No, right. Nobody. But this is destroying the foundations of civilization in our country, not the desire, but the way we are going to relate or describe it as a category of being.
Yeah.
And, you know, just to be clear, cause I've been in these debates, I understand an initial, like, I appreciate your honesty and how you're sort of, it seems like you're discouraged at yourself for sort of going along with it, but there has been a frog in the, you know, pot of boiling water sort of thing. And the word, the terminology of side B 20 years ago, when it first sort of was used, was a little different. It was just a way to say, we're not affirming, these desires exist, but we uphold the Judeo-Christian, you know, the Christian sexual ethic, but that has morphed. And that was the article that I had put, because I kept hearing from this, you know, this individual that's saying where he says, well, like for him to continue to say we're arguing over language at this point, I don't really know how to assess that. So my article shows that every definition of side B at this point contains the identity piece. They want to boil it down to two things. this desire exists and we're going to recognize it. And we uphold the Christian sexual ethic. And my article, this article shows there's a third piece in every definition of it that includes the identity being ontological piece. And that's the problem. Because that's what society is trying to do, is there's these different categorizations and classifications of humanity that takes desire and makes them defining.
Yeah. And I mean, Nate Collins in his book, what, you know, one of the ways that they try to parse it out is the difference between same-sex attraction and same-sex sexual attraction.
Yes.
And so it's like, you know, to be attracted to the same sex is neutral, but it's the sexual component that makes it wrong. But it's like, you know, again, where do we draw that line? Because when you're, you know, holding hands with a dude, is that, you know, that's not sexual. That's just expressing your love for them. Well, maybe so. I mean, like when I lived in Turkey, it was not uncommon to see guys walking down the street holding hands. It was a cultural thing. I actually had the manager of the market that I shopped at grab me by the arm and, you know, take me over to get something off the shelf that I had left there when I bought it earlier, you know. But so it's like, you know, yeah, maybe it's not a romantic expression, but in, you know, sorry, I get sidetracked and I lose my train of thought very easily, but, you know, it's like, okay, well, it may not be romantic, but yet in our culture, that seems to be a romantic gesture, you know? And, you know, and so they'll argue this idea like, well, the same sex attraction, even maybe some of the romantic stuff, because romance is really just cultural. And so maybe it's not really romance. It's, Christopher Yuan in his book, Holy Sexuality and the Gospel, has this paragraph where he like breaks it down and he's like, this is romance. Romance is if you feel jealousy when your friend's relationship status changes. Romance is when, you know, like he just goes through all these scenarios. He's like, that's obvious romance, you know, and we can't quibble about that. And, you know, he cites somebody in the Side B movement who cried for days when their best friend got married to a woman. And it's like, if I'm gonna cry for days, it's gonna be tears of joy, you know? And I mean, like, and that's what Christopher Yuan was saying. He's like, I'm gonna be happy for them. Like, if you're upset about this, you know, I mean, unless it's like everyone sees the red flags going into the marriage, but, you know,
if you're
upset about your friend finding joy in this, there's something wrong with you. And that's not a good thing.
Yeah.
And that so orientation needs to be repented of, not just. Yeah.
So what would you say to the person who says, I'm glad you've been able to find joy and satisfaction in a marriage to the opposite sex, but that I've tried that, I can't, that's I'm not able to do that. What would your response to that person be?
I mean, yeah, I don't want to promise what God does not promise. I'm not going to tell somebody, well, if you just try hard enough, you know, because again, that's what I did for years. I tried to, for lack of a better word, to straighten myself out. And you know, just, yeah, I can appreciate, yeah, you are in a struggle, but before I got married, before I got into the relationship with my wife, I was really wrestling with, okay, well, if to be faithful to God means I never marry and I never get to enjoy the blessings of marriage and I never get to have kids of my own, can I be okay with that? And so prior to being married, I said, yes, I said, God, whatever your calling for my life is, I'm going to stick with you. I'm going to stick with your plan because your plan is good.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah. And so, yeah, I had come to that place before getting into a relationship and, you know, the relationship happened afterwards. But one thing I heard, even when I was in the, in with some of the ex-gay ministries, I believe it was my counselor or maybe someone he was talking to at this conference we were at. I remember someone was talking about this idea, like, well, you know, how do I know I won't fall into sin again after I get married? And they're like, well, you don't. You can't predict that you'll never be tempted by something again, even if you haven't been tempted for 30 years by it. Yeah. You know, like it could happen. And one of the things he said too is like, well, you know, I'm not sure about the sexual attraction to a wife or something, you know. And something that stuck with me, and I can't remember if it was my counselor or the other guy that said it, but one of them said, basically, when your heart and your commitment and all of that are directed towards one person, when you commit yourself to one person, he said, essentially the plumbing will follow. And maybe that's a bit of a crude way to put it, but you know, I found like, you know, I thought my wife was beautiful before we were dating. I didn't want to tell her that because I didn't want to make things awkward, but it was like, I thought she just had a natural beauty about her that I was drawn to. Her character, I mean, she was beautiful. And I was like, you know, I don't want to say this because that's going to make things awkward, but at the same time, you know, so I was drawn to that, but it was like when we started dating and when we got engaged, when it's like I'm deliberately now focusing my attention, my love, my affection, my devotion towards you, that attraction happened. The sexual attraction grew out of that. And so it's like, you know, there's a sense where I want to say, well, just because you don't feel it now doesn't mean it's not going to be there. But again, I don't want to say like, well, don't worry, it'll happen one day.
Right. Yeah. No, I think that's what really was harmful to people is like promising things that we, you know, it's not ours to promise. Mm-hmm. But so that led to, you know, this false expectation, then people gave up. Like part of my testimony is I came to faith during a Ray Bolts concert. You know, Ray Bolts.
Yeah.
Ryan's smirky. You don't know who that is?
I have no idea.
Really? Dude won so many Dove Awards. He had this song Watch the Lamb and Thank You. And it was this song about like a youth pastor that goes to heaven. He didn't think he did any good, and all these people come to him and say, you know, thank you for giving to the Lord. Anyway, it was you were probably a child. Do you know what I'm talking about, Charles, or no?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so this was in the 90s. I was, the late 80s. I came forward, you know, it was one of these, there was an altar call. I came forward and then I went backstage and just, I mean, I remember weeping. I just had a great sense of my need for a savior, of my sinfulness, and that Jesus paid the price. He came out in maybe 15 years ago now. It was maybe 2008, 2009. And mm-hmm. Divorced his wife. He's got adult kids and he became singing in quotes now, because if you're just listening in quotes, Christian songs to and it's like, man, you had a wife and kids, and now the wife and kids all say they support this, and the whole thing is just very odd, but it's very sad to me. It's very sad to me. And I think what you said was really just helpful for anybody in life, like submitting your desires to the Lord's desires. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the cost of discipleship, you know?
Yeah.
Deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me George deny George. And I've found that to be true in a number of phases in my life. I'm 49 now. And there are some things I really had to submit to the Lord that I wanted, and I submitted them to him, and he gave me new desires. I don't know that always happens. I don't know, you know, because I don't want to overpromise. What I want to say is it's, you know, Paul prayed for that thorn in the flesh to be removed how many times? And God said, my grace, you know, Christ said, my grace is sufficient for you. Mm-hmm. And do we really believe that? But I also believe in the power of him to work, you know, miracles and actually change our hearts and actually grow us in the Lord and make us joyful in the midst of that. And so thank you for just sharing that part of it, because I thought that was great.
And it says that what Palmer Robertson said at the General Assembly in 22 at Birmingham, that you have to hold the line, right? That someone comes along and cuts the line and said, this far, no further, that the church needs to hold the line on sexual ethics, because there are people out there who are struggling with this. And if you give them just a little bit of excuse that maybe this is okay, or maybe this aspect is something that I can let go in a small way, it will overwhelm.
Yeah.
And so the church must not tolerate this. There's still a challenge for the PCA from Revoice, would you say?
Yeah, I mean, we see it in the Twitter debates and stuff like that. I'm thankful to say that my presbytery is very much against Revoice. And
is that PD Presbytery? Which presbytery?
PD Presbytery. Yeah,
that's a great presbytery.
In 2022, when Overture 15 was on the docket, my pastor didn't like the wording of it. He felt it was too vague. And so he abstained from voting. He's like, I want to honor the spirit behind it, but I don't think that this is what should be in the thing. And, and I didn't like Overture 15, one, because I was on Revoice's side, but even afterwards, I kind of felt the same way. That's like, I don't think it was clear enough. I think this year's Overture is good. If I understand correctly, it has passed in 2/3 of presbyteries, right?
Oh yes.
Okay. I thought it had. I hadn't been following it. So, yeah. Here's hoping it'll get in the books in the 51st GA.
Yes.
But yeah, with Revoice. And again, I've read from other people who are like, yeah, I used to be side B. I nearly killed myself. Now I'm fully affirming, and now I'm happy. And so it's kind of like I read a lot of those testimonies. I don't know. And I don't want to like toot my own horn here, but you know, I don't know of anyone who has done the opposite, who's been like, yeah, I was side B, but now I see that wasn't good. So now I'm coming against that.
Well, you are. You're
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't want to sound like I'm the only one that's ever done this, but
I think Becca Cook too. Life.
Yeah. And you know, Rosario Butterfield, you know, being from side A to now.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're not as special as you think you are.
Well, I know I'm not special.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, I love Beckett Cook's testimony. Mm-hmm. His book is phenomenal. I've worked through it with people. The A Change of Affection, I think, is what it's called. Change of Affection. And originally, he just thought side B was what he was, because again, that definition has taken sort of a turn.
Right.
And to his credit, he came out and said, no, he didn't come out, but he came, he reject, I mean, it's on his website as a tab to say, you know, a side B retraction. Mm-hmm. I think as our kids are more and more confused in the schools, and they have teachers and peers telling them, well, you might be this because you don't fit the gender stereotype, or you're having odd feelings, or what, you know, you're not, the opposite sex isn't necessarily attracted to them. I don't think we need to be giving kids confusion in their options. And right. Side B does that. Side B gives them this option of saying you may be this, and the best you can hope for is lifelong
palliative care.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And if you actually do have a marriage, it's a mixed orientation marriage. It's you'll farce. Never be a real marriage. It's like, what?
No. Yeah. And that's like, I don't, you know, I used in talking about my marriage for a little bit, you know, well, yeah, I'm in a mixed orientation marriage. But it's like, again, it's like, well, I mean, but those are that, I mean, like the SSA is the sinful side. I know that's like, it's not like I'm, you know, it's not like I'm deliberately saying no to one good thing for another good thing. I'm saying no to something that's corrupted.
Mm.
At best, it's corrupted, you know, and, you know, at worst, it's just twisted. You know, it's absolutely, you know, I'm rejecting that for what God called very good.
Mm.
And marriage is very good. And again, I feel like, you know, Revoice always wants to camp out on 1 Corinthians 7, well, Paul said singleness is better. So, you know, but it's like, but then you're not practicing singleness because you're having these celibate partnerships and this chosen family and all, like, you're not, you know, it, there's a lot of, I guess, contradiction between the words and the practice. Like, you know, if you, even if you go to Revoice's website and you look at their statement of faith, because they're real quick to point that out to people, like, well, have you read our statement of faith? It's like, yeah, your statement of faith sounds okay-ish, but it doesn't get into all of the issues. Like, you know, your statement of faith reads like, well, yeah, I would probably agree with most of that, you know, and again, that's where they couch it in that, well, this is just about terminology. Well, no, it's not. It's about, you know, it's about who did God create us to be? How did God intend for humanity to thrive? How did God intend for humanity to be a blessing? And it's through, you know, through marriage and family. And yes, singleness has a place. We don't want to ignore the single people. But, you know, we don't want to say, well, both are equally good, or even lean to say, well, the singleness is better because then you can do more for the Lord. And it's like, I'm raising up two children who at this point can quote the first 28 catechism questions in the children's catechism.
Well done.
You know, and it's like, how is that like not as good? You know, my goal as a father is to disciple these kids to love the Lord and, you know, to be among his people. And it's like, that's my calling as a father. And, you know, I'm still open and interested in doing missions work. I actually went back a few years ago and got my Master of Arts in Muslim Studies from CIU. And so I've got, you know, like I've still got a desire to reach the world, but, you know, at the same time, my first ministry is my wife and my kids, you know, and my church would have to come next. And that's one of the, again, another thing with Revoice. Revoice seems to be telling people like, you know, well, if your churches aren't supporting you the way that you feel like they should, then you should just leave your church and go form your own little faith community. Mm. And it's like, you know, no, my church has been a lifesaver for me. Shortly after my wife and I got married, my grandma passed away. And our church was there that evening, like less than 2 hours after she passed away, with a meal for us. And, you know, my grandma was buried in New Mexico. So my mom and I had to fly out there. They gave us money for the plane tickets. And my mom saw that. And she said, I don't have that in my life. If something happens to my husband, my stepfather, you know, she says, if something happens to him, I don't have anybody. Mm. I want to be a part of that. My mom's now a member of Westminster.
That's awesome.
You know, and so it's just like my church is, you know, we're going to disagree on things, you know, but my church has been the place where I have heard the truth proclaimed. You know, I have had a pastor who has walked with me on this journey since my early days being there. I opened up to him about 6 months after I started at Westminster. He was our associate pastor at the time, but now he's our lead pastor. And, you know, I mean, he has been encouraging. He has been supportive. He's the one who married my wife and I, you know, and just the support that he continues to give, you know, even with that, I've talked with him since I've kind of left the Side B camp. He knew I went to Revoice and that I was sort of on board. And like I said, even looking back now, I don't think I was fully on board even back then. But, you know, I went from like, well, Revoice is okay to, you know, Revoice isn't good for anybody. You know, even the people involved in it, it's like, you know, you are basing your entire perception of the world on your struggle with sin. You know, and like one of the guys, Grant Hartley, who's big in the Side B circles, he I forget when I ran across it randomly on my Twitter feed, but he said something to the effect of more, you know, and because again, this goes back to they side B will say, well, we're not saying that gay is who we are. We're not saying that that's our primary identity over even over our Christian identity. But then you've got Grant Hartley who tweets out, you know, more important than me being side B is that I'm super, super gay. And it's like, so which is it here? You're basing your identity, you're basing your practice. And he's tweeted some other stuff that was like, again, early on in my like starting to leave Revoice behind were like huge red flags. Like one thing he said is like, yeah, I was at a gay bar and they had a drag show and it was just glorious. And I'm just like, there's something wrong with that. Like I should not find beauty in the deliberate opposition to the Lord, yeah. You know? And so again, all of this just kind of kept taking me back. Like, okay, let's go back ultimately to the scriptures, but let's listen to those that have been speaking against this and see like, you know, were they right after all? Could I possibly be wrong? And
so
I
have two questions, okay. Final questions, right? So the first one is, how do you answer the response? Because I suspect there are a lot of supporters in the PCA of Revoice, not because like they think they're, you know, what is it? Eating and spitting out the bones kind of thing. And the reason they're willing to do that, one is not to ostracize the LGB community, LGBTQ plus. Secondly, it's they view it as necessary because if you're going to reach this next generation that already believes that sexuality is being in personhood, we don't have any other way to reach them. We have to just accept that or give up on that piece to be able to tell them the gospel. How do you answer the fact that this is sort of necessary to reach that group of people?
I mean, it's a really backwards thing, you know? I mean, it would be like telling the Christians who gave their lives for the faith, well, you just need to affirm Caesar as a god. You can still have Jesus, but you need to affirm Caesar also, you know? And so, I mean, there's that. It's like you need to compromise what you believe to reach somebody. What are you reaching them for? You know, and what are you reaching them with? You know, I mean, if someone's already bought into the LGBTQ plus ideology, why did they need Jesus? They've already got like, well, yeah, we know that's who I am. And if we're coming along and saying, yeah, we want to tell you that's who you are, but you can't have sex. Like, well, right. I don't need that. I've got that over, you know, it's like, it doesn't really reach them with anything. And I mean, you know, again, going back to Rosaria Butterfield, she was not won to Christ by compromise. She was not won to Christ by having someone tell her. And she said this, you know, she says that they didn't tell me to, you know, we needed to start a lesbian bowling league for the church. you know, but it's like, that's true. Like Christianity, the gospel didn't spread because it went along with the cultural idols of the day. It didn't pander to those. It opposed those.
It was the contrast that won.
Yeah. And that's the thing. People looked at that and they're like, wait a minute, what's different about these guys?
Well, and that's why I asked early on in this, like, if you had your own sense of the sin, it wasn't just the stigma, but was an internal sort of sense. Cause that's my, I think we all have that. And the more the second use of the law is removed in society, that the harder it is for conscience to work. But my last question is, because I have a theory and I don't know that it's right, but I think side B is going to completely go away. I think it only exists because we're in this middle state. Like we are in the negative world, as Aaron Wren has said, but we're still living, we're still all from the transition. And so there still is a sense that this is wrong culturally, even if that's been mostly suppressed. And so you have people growing up in this and they're saying, well, they're saying this is wrong, but this is how I feel. And the culture is saying this, but like these people growing up, like born and growing up now, there's not going to be any question in their secular minds that this is part of their being. I mean, it's codified in our laws. It's accepted everywhere in government, in the corporate world, in education. And so to tell somebody at that point who grew up just understanding this is who I am, like, yeah, that's who you are. Just don't do this. I just don't think it's going to exist. I think it's going to be coming to Christ as a renunciation of who you are. And so, you know, it's either going to be side A or not, you know, there's not going to be any middle ground of coddling your sin. What do you think about that?
I tend to agree. I actually taught a 5-week Sunday school on gender and sexuality using I always get the title wrong, the New Reformation Catechism on Human Sexuality. Is that right?
Great.
Yeah. Okay. So, and I kind of use that as kind of just a guide to kind of filter my own thoughts. But again, even I've been open in my church about.
Is that from the GRN, by the way?
I think it is. It is.
Yes.
Yes. You bad people in secret societies, you know.
No, we're not. There's nothing secret about the GRN.
I know. I just remember that being a thing.
They have a website and
a 501c3. On it.
Publish things on it.
You know, like if you go to the website, you'll see my name as on the general counsel. There's nothing secretive about
it. I know. I'm just saying that's, yeah.
I like the joke, but I have to always push back on it.
Sorry, my dog's deciding she wants to be in my lap now. So if you see her peek over.
Well, she may identify as a lap dog. And so.
Oh, she definitely identifies as a lap dog. She totally is a lap dog. Come on, Phoebe. Well, her name's Phoebe. Well, we named her after Phoebe in the Epistle of the Romans. So,
well,
this is my dog.
Hello, Phoebe. Well, as we bring it in, what are, you know, one or two things that encourage and one or two things that concern you about the PCA?
I mean, encouraging, I've been really blessed by being a part of the PCA.
For my own walk,
it's been, you know, I don't feel like, you know, like, well, I've got the church for Sundays and then, you know, for the rest of the time, all my other problems, I've got to take somewhere else. You know, again, it's, you know, in our congregation, we're really striving to walk together through life, and all the ups and downs that it may entail. And, so yeah, I'm really encouraged by that, at least in my congregation. I hope all the congregations are sensing that, you know, and I think we're seeing seems to be a lot more unity is growing. I know there are still Revoice supporters in our churches, but it seems like, you know, again, even this time with the sexuality overture, I can't remember what number it is. Two? Overture two? Does that sound right? I
forgot already.
I can't keep track of all the numbers, but but anyway, you know, with that now passing the 2/3 mark, I think that's a positive sign that, you know, again, either, and I mean, I've heard some say, well, you know, all of the good churches, the ones that support Revoice, are leaving the PCA. And it's like, I think it's the other way around. You know, I think, I think maybe some of the ones that need to go are going. And, you know, so I'm encouraged by that. I hope that we continue to move in that direction. Especially on these issues that, you know, we've got to stop pretending that Revoice isn't a problem. You know, and I say this as one who thought that Revoice wasn't the problem. And that's, you know, back sometime after the conference in 2022, I tweeted out something and it was about a related matter. And I was like, come on, this is happening. And you guys think Greg Johnson is the problem? And it's like, you know, well, there can be more than one problem. you know? And so it's like, and that's, again, that was another reason that led me to just say, like, I need to verbally declare that I no longer support this stuff. I can't just, you know, again, Rosaria Butterfield in her article about using preferred pronouns. That's what really started me saying, like, I need to make a public statement about this, because I made public statements to the contrary. And like she said, public sin demands public repentance. And so it's like, you know, okay, well, I need to do this. I need to say we've got to stop saying this isn't a problem. Hmm. You know, and I feel like even people like Tim Keller kind of towed the line too much. Like he said, you know, we don't have a side B problem. We rejected side B in the sexuality report. And then he says, hey, Greg Johnson's book is excellent. Go read it. And it's like, that's
those two can't both be true.
Yeah. It's like, you know, if I tell people to read Greg Johnson's book at this point, I would say, you know, yeah, read it with great suspicion at best. You know, my wife got me a few years ago a book stamp that says heretical nonsense for research purposes only. And so I was like, I'm thinking about like just stamping that in there. But it's like, you know, and again, you know, this is for us as a denomination, we need to be clear in our language. We need to be clear in the way we speak, because that's one of the things that Revoice and Side B seem to like to do, is play with words. It's like, well, you know, like, for example, going back to Overture 15, you know, it says, you know, men who describe themselves as homosexual are not fit for office. So basically is what it said. And so I saw some Side B people saying, well, it's a good thing we don't describe ourselves as homosexual. You know, again, it was playing with words.
Yeah.
Right. And it's like, you're missing the point. But again, and that's again why I felt like Overture 15 wasn't our best attempt to deal with this issue.
Yeah, well, you hit the nail on the head with the language, because the truth is these people are the biggest legalists around. They're not antinomian, they're legalists. So, well, you said we can't describe ourselves as homosexuals. Well, that's fine. The word gay isn't in there, so now I can describe myself as gay. It's like, right. No, what does the word mean?
Right.
So, well, Charles, this was awesome. And just thank you for your honesty. And I mean, you lived this, you walked it. I am so hopeful by your testimony, just for my own sanctification, for this, you know, what we have to offer people. So I really appreciate that. Ryan, I appreciate you co-hosting this with me.
Oh, thanks for letting me be a part.
Thanks for letting me be a part. So, so I don't know if it's going to air on mine or yours first, but for my listeners, Presbyterian and Reformed churchmen, I definitely recommend the Westminster Standard Podcast, a podcast of Jude 3 and the PCA. And I think at this point, everybody knows who you are, Ry, but Ryan is a friend, even if we dress and look different, we can laugh about the same things. So I don't know if you have anything to end with, Ryan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for letting me come and share. I feel honored. As I told you before we started, you know, I didn't know what was going to happen when I tweeted that out. But I just knew that I needed to do it, because the Lord kept pressing me on it. And it was like, I got it. I just need to do it. So thank you for giving me a chance to kind of explain myself maybe a little better, hopefully. And yeah, feel free to, you know, tell people to ask me any questions about anything that I wasn't, you know, clear on. So,
and they can find you on Twitter.
They can find me on Twitter. I'm on all the social medias. I'm also starting a travel agency, so if they look up Destinations Travel, they can find me there. They'll probably find like 100 other Destinations Travels before that. But anyway.
All right. Well, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you.
The heart of BTS is first and foremost to be faithful. Faithful to the Word of God, to the sufficiency of Scripture, to knowing we serve a sovereign Lord. The second component of the heart of BTS is accessibility. We're affordable. We're flexible. We work with students to help them achieve goals. This isn't our journey. It's your journey for serving the Lord. It's your journey that God has called you to. So we pray that while God expands and grows the opportunities that we have, that we never lose sight to provide quality, reformed theological education faithfully and accessibly, so that we can serve the local church by building leaders for His kingdom.